Hello everybody, welcome to Youth Night.
Amen.
And the best way to start off this night is with prayer. Any prayer requests in the choir?
Remember me tonight.
Am I right?
Remember Mom and our children, please.
Continue to remember Mom.
Remember Susan and Steve, please.
My wife.
Remember lost my family and thank God for what all he's done for us.
I have the same mom that I had this morning. Remember Ernie Meadows, he voted, and Willie Bowles, cancer.
Spiritual needs in my family. I have a special request.
My daughter-in-law from Georgia, her name is Teresa Elston. She has to have gallbladder surgery Tuesday, so please remember her. I don't believe she's saved, I don't know.
Unspoken. Brother Kenny, would you pray?
Father, I want to thank you for who you are, Father. I want to thank you for the Savior that you are. God, I want to thank you for this gathering tonight. I just thank you for these people. Father, I just ask you for your will to be done. Yeah. Father, in life, I pray that, Lord, these sicknesses, illnesses, I just pray, Lord, that you touch them. Father, you know best. Father, just even the unsaved, Lord, I just pray that you open up their hearts and receive you in.
Yeah.
Father, I just never forget them in our prayers and put them first. Bring them before you, Father. You just like to be saved on our way to heaven. Father, we just love you and praise you and ask you to bless the speaker tonight. Just tell you how much we love you in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for it.
Amen.
God, I'm free. Emily and
I travel down a long, lonely road. My heart was so heavy and I sank low. Then I heard about Jesus. What a wonderful hour. I'm so glad that I found out he would bring me out through his saving
power. Bring me out and
poor man that God gave back his sight. Like the poor wretched beggar, found fortune and fame. I'm so glad that I found out he would bring me out through his holy name. When he moves among us, all that he does, all of his mercy and all of his love, if the pen of our writer could write every day, even this world could never contain. I have been blessed. Warmth in the winter, flowers in spring, laughter in summer, the changing of leaves, fruit on my table, a good place to sleep, clothes on my back and shoes on my feet. I have been blessed.
I have been blessed. I'm so good to be. Precious are his loves of you and me. No way I could count them. There's not enough time. So I'll just thank him for being so kind. God has been good.
Voice that can talk, hands that can touch, and legs that can walk, ears that can listen, eyes that can see. I've got to praise him as long as I breathe. I have been blessed. A father and mother to nurture and raise, brother and sister, memories made. Our pastor to lead us, his altar to pray. Stripes that can heal, the blood that still saves. I have been blessed.
I have been blessed, a servant to me. Precious are his thoughts of you.
The greatest on earth, our flag stands for freedom and what it is worth. She stands in the harbor, Miss Liberty calls. All have gave some, but some gave it all, so we could be blessed.
He's my shoulder to lean on when I am down. The rock where he
under him. condition. I bowed in full contrition. Now I'm in a new position since I made up my mind.
I made up my mind. No matter what others say, I will follow Christ and walk in His ways. The battle of His heart and the road is steep. That's okay. I've set my heart on becoming like Christ, dying with Him and raised to life. All things of this world I'm leaving behind, 'cause I made up my mind.
Make a choice. Would I run or take a stand against this evil force? But after all God's done for me, and His blood has set me free, I choose to walk in liberty, 'cause I made up my mind.
I made up my mind, no matter what others say, I will follow Christ and walk in His ways.
Specials or testimonies?
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you for this good day He's given us.
Yeah.
Thank God for your mercies.
Yeah.
It's the second. We wouldn't have food on the table if it wasn't for the good Lord.
Amen.
It's thank you for the opportunities He's given us, the families and friends and good places to come to church to hear His precious word.
Amen.
I need to stand and thank God for His mercies on me. I thank you for His love and His salvation. I thank you for the youth that's in this church.
Amen.
I pray that they always have a desire to serve, and I pray that I'm always in a position where I can be used, and I just thank you for what He does for me.
Amen.
Scripture songs.
All right, welcome to youth night. We're going to start out with our new song. So if you turn to your Bible in 2 Chronicles 7:14. Like this. You guys ready? If my people, which are called by my name,
ourselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land.
So it's not too difficult. Are you guys ready? Okay, let's go over it again then.
If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land.
So tonight we're just going to stay in the book of Psalms. So if you turn to Psalms 19, we're going to sing verses 7 through 10. 7, 8, and 9 are the verses. 10 is the chorus. So just sing 10 after each verse. And we'll just sing them all together. Ready?
The la la.
Can we restart?
The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb.
Verse 8.
The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord is true, enlightening the eyes. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb.
Verse 9.
The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey.
One is unto thee, O Lord, in Psalms 25, 1 through 4. So, Dad, you can come lead the ladies' part. I even got too loud. All right, are we ready? Okay. All right, I'm ready.
Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul.
Lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord,
do I lift up my soul.
Do I lift up my soul.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
I trust in thee.
Let me not be ashamed, let not my enemies triumph over me.
Yea, let none that way,
yea, let none that way,
on thee be ashamed,
on thee be ashamed,
yea, let none that way,
yea, let none that way,
on thee be
ashamed. On thee be ashamed.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
I trust
in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me.
Show me thy ways.
Show me thy ways.
Thy ways, O Lord.
Thy ways, O Lord.
Teach me thy path.
Thy path, O Lord.
Thy path, O Lord.
I learn.
Oh my God.
I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me.
All right, our next one is Psalms 34:8. I think this is the day. Oh, it's the Lord is good. All right. And see that the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. If you turn over to Psalms 46, verse 10, be still and know that I am God. It's actually only the first line, but ready?
Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. When trials come near, never doubt, never fear. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. When trials come near, never doubt, never fear. Be still and know that I'm God.
Okay, now we're going to Psalms 51, verse 10 and 11. This is probably my favorite scripture verse, a scripture song, but this is one we learned last week.
Within me.
Let's sing it one more time. I like that one a lot. Yes, ma'am.
Oh. Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Restore me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
All right, right, Psalms 89, verse 1. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord.
I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing, I will sing. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. For my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness, thy faithfulness. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing, I will sing. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord.
All right, our last one, we're going to do Psalms 118, 24. This is the day.
This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made.
Special for testimonies.
Amen.
Thank the Lord.
We pray.
as if every promise from your word is not enough, and all the while you hear each desperate plea. Yet long that we have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come?
Wonderful exchange, cold in my sin, Christ suffered 'neath God's rage. Draped in his righteousness, I'm justified. In Christ I live, for in my place he died.
I cling to Christ and marvel at the cost. Jesus forsaken, God estranged from God. Bought by such love, my life is not my own. I praise my all shall be for Christ alone.
His robes tore mine, God's justice is appeased. Jesus is Christ, and thus the Father's pleased. Christ drank God's wrath on sin, then Christ is done. Sin's wages paid, propitiation won.
I cling to Christ and marvel at the cost. Jesus forsaken, God estranged from God. Bought by such love, my life is not my own. My praise, my all, shall be for Christ alone. His robes for mine, such anguish none can know. Christ, God's beloved, condemned as though his foe. He has, though I, accursed and left alone. I, as though he, embraced and welcomed home. I cling to Christ and marvel at the cost. Jesus forsaken, God estranged from God. But by such love, my life is not my own. My praise, my all, shall be for Christ alone.
Any others? Congregation?
Sure.
To see those that were able to make it out to youth night tonight. Didn't the youth do great tonight?
Amen.
I truly appreciate the youth that we have in this church and the support that the church has always given the youth. It's been a blessing to me since I was in the youth and all the time since then, so I appreciate that. Going to be going over, to me, a subject that's sore in need of hitting on, especially in all the things that are going to be going on, and that is the subject of peace. Peace. And we're going to turn in your Bibles to John chapter number 14. John chapter number 14. And we're going to be starting with verse number 25. John chapter 14, starting with verse 25. These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Shall we go to prayer? Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for this night. We thank you for the youth in our church, dear Lord, and we thank you for what they meant to us and their ministry that they've given to us tonight, dear Lord, through songs and their willingness to do what you'd have them to do. We thank you for also for saving us, dear Lord, so many years ago, and we thank you for the opportunity to be saved. We just pray you be with each one of us, dear Lord. Help us to be the Christians you'd have us to be. Help us to be the example in this lost world that we need to be. We ask you to be with us as we come forth tonight to bring forth this lesson. We just ask you to give us the words to say. Also giving those listening attentive ears and hearts that what we have to say might be able to encourage them in their Christian walk. We also pray most importantly that if there one be here tonight, dear Lord, that don't know you, that the words I say might be able to bring them to you before it's everlasting too late. We ask you to be with us as we go throughout the remainder of the service, be with them in your requests that have been brought forth in the prayer request time. You know the needs in each one there and answer each in your own special way. For asking in your blessed and holy name, amen. Amen. Alrighty, peace. You know, in today's society, one of the things that I think is amazing and annoying to no get out is how accessible we are. I want you to think about your own life. Think about your day-to-day business and think about how accessible you are. How much information gets shoved your way any second that you're on this earth? It's sad. People will be hanging up trim in the church. Oh, we're doing a good job. Beep, 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 beep. Wait a second, I gotta go get this. You'll be in your prayer time. Beep, beep, beep. Oh, I gotta get this. You'll be like Brother Marty trying to do a message up here when we were recording for COVID. Ring, ring, ring. Oh man, I forgot to turn that thing off again. Think about how accessible you are. Anybody can get you anytime, anywhere. All they have to do is pick up the phone and call you, and all of a sudden you're getting annoyed by it. It's hard to get peace that way. Think about your life and the information that continually flows your direction. You turn on the TV, you hear about COVID, you hear about Antifa, you hear about riots, you hear about fires, you hear about storms. You hear for a week about a winter storm that's coming your way and going to blanket you with 2 foot of snow. And it comes and it gives you 2 inches. But for a steady week, every single day, you're hearing how bad this is going to be. Anytime you click on it, you talk to people. Oh, the storm is coming. It's going. We need to get ready for it. We hear about politics. Every single, oh man, if this happens, it's going to be catastrophic. Oh, and we hear about it for a year before it even comes around. Every single day, everywhere you go, you pick up the paper, there it is. You turn on the TV, there it is. You pick up your phone, there it is. You even leave your phone down, and all of a sudden it starts making noise. Well, is that a text, or is that something I need to look at? Oh, it's the stupid news again. Everywhere we go, we are flooded with news. Bad news, usually. We're constantly being pulled, constantly being told how bad things are and how miserable life is. We're missing peace. We are missing being able to be content. It is so bad. People are starving for peace. Starving to the fact that they will do almost anything to have peace in their life. Some are so desperate for peace at their wits' end that the only peace that they can see in their life is to end it. Every day, notice this statistic, not every year or every week or every month, but every day, 132 people commit suicide. 132 people every single day in the U.S. That is amazing to me. 1,500 people attempt it every single day. Their life has gotten so chaotic, and to the point to where they see no end but to end it. That is scary.
Yeah.
All because they want peace. A good song, if you have time sometime, is to look up the song by the Isaac called Peace. And it talks about this phenomenon, about how people are starving for peace. Peace is defined as a state of tranquility, freedom from disquieting or oppressive thoughts, harmony in personal relationships, a state of mutual concord, getting along. So why is peace so elusive? Why is it that this thing that everybody wants, everybody needs, people are craving, why is it so elusive to them? Well, here's some of my thoughts. For the lost world, they're too busy looking for it. They are too busy looking for peace. And you're like, well, that don't make a whole lot of sense, but I want you to think about it. Many people believe that all my life would be perfect. I would have no worries whatsoever if I just was a millionaire. If I just made a little more money. If I just had a little bit better job. I'd have a little bit more finances coming in. I'd be able to handle anything. Life would be great. So what do? They chase the almighty dollar. Every minute of their life is dedicated to how they're going to make a buck. Working a little longer, working a little harder, trying to figure out a new way of shucking and jiving to get a little bit of money out of somebody else. Sometimes it's successful, they can increase their money. But along the way, what typically happens is they destroy their lives. I have yet to see a man at the end of their life say, man, I wish I'd have worked more. What I typically hear is, I wish I'd have spent more time with my family. I wish I would have spent more time in church. Very rarely is it, I wish I'd have worked more. And one of the things that I felt kind of funny is no matter how much money a person gets, they want more. They want more. Think about it. Every job that I've had in my career, I've got a raise with it. Bump up in pay. Sometimes significant, sometimes not, but a bump up in pay. But yet, even with that, I find, well, what's the next job that can get me that next bump? And what I've often found with that next bump, cause a whole lot more stress, a whole lot more worries, a whole lot more accountability, more pressure on me. So the world, they're too busy looking for peace through money. Many times they seek peace through various drugs. That's the world's solution to it. If you want peace in your life, here, take this pill. Everything will be fine. It'll calm you down. Everything will be fine. Some statistics that I found that it's shocking when you really think about it. The last statistics that I could find, over 13% of adults in the U.S. are on antidepressants. I don't know, just that statistic itself makes me depressed. Think about that. 13%. 21% of American adults report drinking moderately to excessively every single day. In 2016, 28.6 million admitted to overusing prescription medication. To find peace. Estimated that 8.76 million people in the United States are currently substance abusers. And for many of them, it's to find peace. One of the things about substances, when you're coming off of them, you have to maintain so much. Most substances you have to maintain just to be normal. Many drugs, if you start out taking one pill, by the time that you're on that drug for 6 months or more, it takes two pills to make that same amount of effect just for you to be normal. Or just a little bit of it to keep you from feeling like dirt. So they want that peace. They want to be able to forget. That's the reason why drugs are so easy. In many ways, it helps people forget their problems. It helps people to take a little bit of time when they're not worrying about it because they're feeling so good, they're just going with it. So many times the world is too busy seeking peace through drugs. Many times the world are too busy seeking peace through relationships. There are many, many people out there that every aspect of their life, their relationship life, the purpose is to find peace. They think if they can go somewhere else, they're not going to run into somebody that has a problem, that irritates them, that gets on their nerves, that bothers them a little bit.
Yeah.
Think about how many people have left a job that you worked at because they couldn't get along with other people there. Think about how many relationships of the people that you know, when trouble came in that relationship, they just jumped ship and went to the next one. And then to the next one. And then to the next one. See, an interesting statistic as I was preparing for this, the average American adult has 8 partners in their lifetime. Between 4 and 8, it depends on which study you look at, between 4 and 8 partners in their lifetime. And why is that? Because they can't have peace with the first one that they got. They couldn't live in tranquility with that first one that they got. And they're like, oh, well, this one's not working out. It's not working out with Diana, so I'm going to go to Sally Sue.
Be careful.
Well, I wasn't going to use anyone out there because that could get any worse. Anyway. But think about it. Think about how people, if a problem arises, they jump ship and go somewhere else. If problem arises, they jump ship and go somewhere else. Whether it be their job, whether it be their marital relationships, whether it be the people that they hang out with, if something comes up, they go, well, I don't need them anymore. I'm going on. I don't need them. I'm going my way. Blah, blah, blah. And what I've often found is once they go that way, they still don't leave that person behind. That person still comes up in conversations. Well, you remember how Sally Sue did me. Am I right?
Yeah, you're right.
So they're too busy trying to find peace by bouncing from relationship to relationship to relationship. And what I think is curious about all that, what is the constant in all those relationships? They are.
Yeah, that's right.
So the problem might not necessarily be with who they're with, but them.
Yeah.
And trying to figure that out. What's wrong with me? And I might get some peace. I also found when I start looking at this, is that many of the lost world out there tries to create peace on their own. I'm going to get me a self-help book, 20 ways to be peaceful with yourself or like yourself, and that's going to fix me. Or I'm going to start meditating. And I'll get inner tranquility within myself.
Yeah.
And everything's going to be fine. One of the other main reasons I think that the world is so difficult for them to find peace, it's so elusive for them, is because they're too busy running from God.
Amen.
They're too busy running from God. The person that can provide peace without limit, beyond our understanding, but they don't want it. It scares them. Being a Christian scares many lost people. They don't know how it's going to change their lives. It's an unknown to them. And the unknown's scary. What's it going to be like when I get saved? What's it going to be when I tell my husband, my wife, my boyfriend, my girlfriend, hey, I'm saved now, I can't do that stuff anymore? What's that going to create in my life? What kind of problems is that going to be? So it scares them. So they run from it. Sometimes they're running from God because of me. Because of you. As Pastor Marty was talking this morning, our lives is what people see. Our lives is what the Christ that most of this world observes. And they look at it and say, well, if Brother Edwin's an example of a Christian, not for me. Thank you very much. I don't want to go that route. If I'm going to become a Christian and complain about how Pastor Marty preaches and teaches and what he does to his kids, why do I want to do that? Think about it. Think about if someone was looking at your life, looking for a way to find peace, and they look at your life.
Yeah.
Are you exhibiting the peace that God gives you in your life? Or are you just like they are? Except you come to church on Sundays. Think about it. For many, they're running from it because it's not the right time for them. I like my life as it is. I get to go here. I get to have fun. I get to do this. I get to do that. Give me a few years, and I'll be glad to settle down and sit in a pew and say amen. They don't want it now. They want to have their fun and then get life insurance later or fire insurance later. So it's not now. Now, the world. One of the things I like about the scripture that I read, it says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world gives. Give I unto you, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Now, it's easy for me to understand and for me to wrap my head around why the world don't have peace. That's an easy answer. It can boil down to just one simple statement. The reason why the world don't have peace is because they don't have Christ.
Amen.
Easy answer.
Yeah.
All those other things are just superficial things that are ways that they try to find peace. But it all boils down to they don't have peace because they don't have Christ. But that causes me a question. Why don't you have peace?
It's good, brother. It's good.
You have Christ. So why don't you, as a Christian, have peace? He just said, we'll read it again. Real easy. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. It's yours. So why don't you have it? Some thoughts. I believe many Christians are too busy to receive God's peace. They are too busy to receive God's peace. Many times in my Christian life, I'll talk about me because that's the only one I can tell you about wholeheartedly. Many times in my Christian life, I get too busy for God. And I would hazard to guess that many of you do too. I get too busy to read. I get too busy to pray. I get too busy to listen to gospel music. I get too busy to go out when the church goes out. I get too busy for all the things that are expected of me by God. I get too busy for them. I am too busy running around, whether it be with work, whether it be with family, whatever. I get too busy. And I don't take time to look for the peace that is right there. I don't take time to open up the Bible and see what He has in store for me. I don't have time. I also find that in many times when I'm in those situations and I'm running around and going everywhere and not taking time to look here, what I find myself doing, and probably when I find myself most stressed, is when I'm trying to fix the problems myself.
Yeah.
Anybody relate to that?
Yeah.
Trying to fix the problem myself. Finances are a problem. Well, I will just work more. I'll get another job. I'll try to figure out a different way of doing it. I'll find a way to get more money in. I'll find a way to pinch pennies here, go here. I'll find a way to save here. I'll do this. Problems within friends or family. I'll find a way. I'll find a way. I'll make it up to them. I'll find a way to make this right to them. I'll find a way. Health issues pop up in our life. Well, I'll find a way. I'll go to this doctor. I'll go to this doctor. I'll go to that doctor. If that one don't work, I'll get a referral to here. And if that don't work, I'll get a referral to there. And if that don't work, I'll go somewhere else. I will find a way to fix this problem. So many times, the reason why we don't have peace is we're too busy to let God show it to us, and we're too busy trying to fix it for ourselves.
Yeah.
We're so convinced that we're so invincible. I can do it. Just step back, I'll do it. And you start working on something, and it don't work, and you get frustrated. And then your relationships fail because you start barking. Okay, how many of y'all have ever had one of those days where you've been trying to do it all yourself?
Yeah.
And somebody just say the most innocent thing, and then all of a sudden they end up in tears because of what you said.
Yeah.
Now, those four of you raised your hand. I think the rest of you are liars. Seriously. You know, a lot of times I think the reason why Christians don't have peace, and that's so elusive to us, is because we're so busy trying to act like the world. We are so busy trying to fit in, trying to do what they do, go where they go, keeping up with the Joneses, keeping up appearances, that we're not letting God work in our lives. We're trying to be so much like the world that we're even taking on their habits. I would hazard to guess that everyone in here, if you thought for more than a minute, could probably think of a Christian who was a solid Christian, and then all of a sudden they were on a bottle. Or taking a little bit more drugs than they were supposed to. They may not be a drug addict, but that doesn't mean they're taking it the way that they're supposed to. Or jumping from relationship to relationship. We're acting like the world instead of going to where peace comes from. Why is peace so elusive to Christians? We're too busy. We're trying to act like the world. I personally think number three is probably one of the larger ones. We're too busy running from our call. We are too busy running from our call. Whether that is, hey, you need to be in the nursery. Hey, you need to be in the choir. Hey, you need to go talk to that person. Hey, you need to be a preacher. Hey, you need to be a teacher. Hey, you need to go talk to that person about Christ. I think one of the biggest reasons Christians don't have peace in their life is because they're kicking against God's pricks.
That's good.
To say, this is the way that you're supposed to be going. And we kick it. And we buck it. And we don't want to go that right. For whatever reason. We're scared. We don't know what it'll be like. Whatever the reason. We don't know how they will react. But you don't have peace within your life because he's trying to work with you. He's trying to get you to think, hey, something's not right here. Hey, I need to move in this direction. But so many times we don't.
Good.
Common example, think of the preachers out there. How many preachers have you heard say, I wish I would have answered the call sooner? How many people have you heard testify, I wish I went to talk to that person sooner? There are so many opportunities in this church and will be even greater as we're doing greater works that God's going to be calling each and every one of us to do something.
Good.
Are you going to have peace?
Good.
Or are you going to kick against the pricks and buck it? It's been my experience that when I start bucking, he starts pushing. He starts letting me know, hey, that's not the way I want you to go. You're not doing what I need you to do. And so my peace starts to diminish. Many of y'all can remember what it was like when Daddy got mad. Y'all remember when Daddy got mad, right? It's the same kind of concept. You don't have that relationship. You don't have that communication. You don't have that peace, that harmony within that relationship. Think about Jonah. Prime example of somebody going where they weren't supposed to go. Going against the grain. Going what they wanted to do. Not following their call. Storm comes up, he still ignored it. Things got worse, he still ignored it. He ended up in the belly of a whale. I don't know about y'all, but I don't want to be in a stinky belly of a whale. I don't want to go there. But that's where we get many times. In the belly of the whale. Because we've bucked so hard. Now, real quickly, how do we get peace? How do we get peace? The thing that is so elusive to so many people. If you don't know Christ, you have to get to know Him. That is the only way that you will ever find true peace, is to know Him. And what's sad, when I was talking about those statistics, when you think about that 132 deaths per day, because they wanted peace. The sad part is, I would guess, I don't know, but I would guess the majority of that 132 people are not in peace right now. My guess is those 132 people are in the worst turmoil that they have ever been in. They thought that killing themselves would be the ultimate answer, would give them peace. But that just amped it up that much more. So, if you're lost, the only way you will ever have a hope of any peace in your life is to know Christ.
Amen.
Now, those of us that are saved, turn your Bibles to Colossians chapter number 3. Colossians chapter number 3. And we're going to be starting with verse number 8. But now ye also put off all these things, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communications out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in the, renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision or uncircumcision, barbarian, Sicilian, bond or free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so do ye. And above all these, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Now going through that, and I'm not going to go through all those things for the sake of time because I've already went longer than most people would like probably. But anyway, the idea is, one of the reasons why peace isn't there for many of us as Christians is we still have all those things in front of us. We are still being, we still have wrath, we still have malice, we still have blasphemy, we still have filthy communications, we still lie from time to time. All those things that are mentioned up there are not part of our lives. I mean, are still part of our lives, so we need to get rid of them. That is how you're going to have peace within your fellow man, with your fellow wives, and with your church members, is through those, getting rid of those things and putting on those other things that were mentioned down below. Forbearing one another, forgiving one another, putting on the bowels of mercy, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, and above all, charity, love. Love one another.
It's good. It's good.
If we would do that, peace would be much more prevalent in your life.
Amen.
Turn to Philippians. This will be our last text for tonight. Philippians, chapter number 4. Probably some of my favorite verses in the Bible. Philippians 4, starting with verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, well, we'll stop right there. Well, think about it. Rejoice in the Lord always. Rejoice. It is very hard to be worrying about things when you're rejoicing about things. It's very hard to do that.
It's good.
But so many times, we are not rejoicing over what we have. We are not rejoicing with the benefits that we have in Christ Jesus. The eternal life, the home in heaven, the fellowship one with another, His guidance from day to day. All those things we're forgetting about. We're so worried about what's going on around us and to us and everything else that we're forgetting about that and we're not rejoicing. It says in there, let your moderation be known. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Made known to God, unto God. It is also very hard to worry when you're praying. Because if you're truly praying and saying, God, here is my burden, it's yours. It's very hard to worry about it unless you do this and take it back. Be careful for nothing, but in all things, through prayer and supplications, let your requests be made known. Many, many Christians, faithful Christians, they have problems come in their life, and they pray, and they take it to God. And then as soon as that prayer's over, they pick it up and take it back with them. Instead of leaving it there and say, God, it's yours. I'm yours. You take it. One of the biggest blessings that I've ever got in this church was when Tammy Mills was sitting back there facing an unknown certainty, not knowing if she is going to have a lung this time, a year later, you know, coming. And she gets up and says, God's got this. Think about that. That was life and death for Tammy. You can't get much more serious than that. And she said, here, God, it's yours. Talk about a blessing. Come what may, positive or negative, she said, God, it's yours. It is what it is. Are you doing that with your problems, with your burdens, with your concerns, with your issues? Are you saying, God, it's yours, I'm done? Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, in verse 8, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. It's hard to worry when you're thinking about the good things instead of the bad. Any one of us could give a laundry list of what all bad's happening in this world, in our lives, in the things around us. If you think you can give me much more positive than you can negative, though. If you concentrate on whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are just, so on and so forth, if you focus on those, the rest will fade away from your mind. Concentrate on those things.
Good.
But so many times we don't. And I like the last part. And the God of peace shall be with you. No matter what you're facing, no matter what calamity, no matter what stress, think on those things. The God of peace will be with you through it all.
It's good.
Peace. We all want it. The lost, the saved. What's keeping you from your peace? Do you have perfect peace in your life right now? Or are you worried about something? Are you stressed? Are you anxious about things that you're facing? One of the best places to go, if that's you, is right up here. Give it to Him. Let it go, and then think about all the blessings that God has given you. Can we have a congregation, please?
Two hundred ninety-six.
Thank you. encourage you tonight, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, tonight's the night. I encourage you tonight, if you have a burden that you've been holding on to, tonight is the night. Don't keep holding on to it. Give it to God and let go. Those things that are working in your mind that are keeping you up at night, this is the place to get rid of them. Give them to Him and let them go. If you're struggling with that, come forward. Give it to God and then tell us, hey, pray for me. Help me to overcome this. Pray for me that I will give the strength to give it to God and let go. Anyone at all? While we're singing this song, come forward. Give it to God. Get your peace tonight. Praying. Anyone else? Nobody else has problems here tonight. That's good to know. Everybody else is peace when they can lay down in their bed tonight. Are you saved? Do you know it? Debbie just continues to play, heads bowed, eyes closed tonight. As she continues to play, and these are up here praying. Tonight, do we have anybody that has burdens on their hearts tonight that said, hey, you know what? I'm facing stuff right now. I'm facing battles right now. Anybody, by the raise of the hand, willing to say that? Hands going up. Others tonight. Anyone else? Here tonight that would say, hey, you know what? I want that peace. I want to know Christ. I want to be able to have peace when I lay down my head at night. Are there anyone here that would raise their hand and say, hey, you know what? I'm not saved, but I want you to pray for me. Anyone at all? We sing one more verse, and those that have burdens and would like to lay them down, come on forward.